Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Welcome to this beautiful spring-like July evening. I was thinking about, Brettley said something today on Facebook that really, I don't know if anybody saw her post, but it really struck home with me. And I think it was a quote from one of the pastors that is out in Bethel, but it said that God is our Father, and it's His kingdom. And so when we talk about our brothers and sisters, when we talk about anything having to do with God's kingdom, if we're not talking about family, then we're not talking about the kingdom. And that really struck me in how we deal with people in our family, right? Our church family is no different from our regular family. We have our favorites. We have those relationships that are easier. We have those relationships that are always difficult. And we love them no less because they're family, but, you know, we do what we can to have healthy relationships and however we can. And it said something about that when we're looking at unbelievers, we're to be their father. We're to be their mothers and fathers, and that the world is crying out for people that will really be mothers and fathers, because mothers and fathers love selflessly. And that is the kind of love that our Father wants us to understand. It's a selfless love that doesn't think about my hurt feelings or that, you know, I mean, how many times did you make your parents cry, but you never questioned whether they loved you? You questioned whether you were deserving of their love, right? It was never in question if my mom loved me. It was just questioning of, oh my, I don't really deserve her love. But she never gave up on me. Our parents never give up on us. They never stop to hope the best for us, and they never stop to give us the best they can possibly give us. And that's what we're to be to each other in the body of Christ, and that's what we're to be to the world that is so lacking for examples of what true mothers and fathers do and are and should be. We're surrounded by messages of what family is, and that's not what family is all the time. It, you know, I'll just leave it at that, but you know what I mean. Family, unconditional love, the love of a father that we are to shed abroad in a world that doesn't know him. So I encourage you that when we run across those people that probably need love more than anybody, those most difficult tend to be the ones that need kindness and love the most. Just remember, that's your brother, that's your sister, that's your daughter. That's someone that just needs the same love your father's given you. And like we talked about last Sunday, just introduce them. Introduce them. It's those simple introductions that you just never know what are going to bear some kind of fruit later on.
Saving the lost, which is not, I mean, not that we
it's just not possible for us as a body to put all that responsibility on the pastor, or if there's someone that takes a role of more evangelist. It's just, I feel like in our culture, like I've done all those network marketing companies, and they're like, just get the people to me and I'll convert them. It's kind of how I'm thinking. That's kind of the mentality of the church, it seems like, is get them to a meeting, get them to someone who can do it, rather than, it's not about getting them to the church.
Right.
It's about getting them to Jesus.
Yeah, they'll come.
And it's about letting them know who he is.
Exactly.
And how to live a life with
the
him.
The church is a whole different dynamic than what we have.
Yeah.
When I say we, I mean the body has basically used it for. We keep preaching how to get saved to people. I mean, that was one of my biggest complaints when I was in the other organization, was every single message you heard was about being born again. Okay, that's fine, except that 90% of the people in that church were already born again. They needed to know, what do I do with this born again experience? And they were never really being discipled. We were always focusing on the get saved. And so the people never really matured in. I mean, and a lot of the people that come, they respond, but then without any knowledge to know what to do with this new life, they soon drift away. I mean, they just kind of fade off and you don't see them anymore. So one-on-ones are always the best in terms of relationship, because it's just that. It's one-on-one. You can focus on the needs of that one individual. They feel a sense of bonding and connection. It just makes it easier. Not necessarily easier for the one teacher, because sometimes it's like Alcoholics Anonymous or whatever. You're getting phone calls at 3 o'clock in the morning. You know, wow, there's a devil in my closet, you know, or I'm married to one or whatever, you know, those kind of things that you have to deal with.
Yeah.
But for the most part, the sheep beget sheep. That's the simplest part of it. It isn't that I don't have a responsibility to do the same thing, because on one hand, I am a sheep too. I'm
right.
Part of the flock. But as a position of pastor, the focus isn't as much about saving as it is about mentoring and teaching and discipling. And of course, because we're all priests, we all have that same responsibility. But I think we've just gone away from that. We go out and we think, okay, I witnessed to somebody, and then that's the end of it.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, we'd be better off if we just prayed about it and allowed them. Well, I'm just throwing this out there for anybody that wants to, but if you pray about it and ask the Lord to lead you to that person, it may not be who you think it is, but there's somebody there. There's somebody in your, you know, in the relationships that you already have that you can begin to disciple. And you just have to use wisdom. It isn't, you know, I mean, things like you see that they're sick. So, you know, they don't have to be believers. You can say, well, you know what the Bible says about that. And they're like, who believes the Bible? Well, look, you know, what do you got to lose?
Right.
And if they read it, it'll touch them. It'll affect them. We know that the Word of God
yes.
changes people, whether
yes,
they
does.
Expect it to happen or not. I can't tell you how many people over the years that just started reading the Bible that were quote-unquote atheists, claiming to be atheists, and they started reading them, and all of a sudden they thought, wow, if this were true, wouldn't it be great? You know?
Yeah.
So,
or if they go out to disprove the Word and end up finding themselves in
exactly.
the Word. Yeah.
We even hear about Muslims, other faiths,
yeah.
other Jews, and mm-hmm. others that the Old and New Testament, all of a sudden, oh, wait a minute, there's a lot of truth in this.
Yeah. Well, and in our women's Bible study, we also talked about how do we keep connected outside the church walls just as a body here. It's hard because we're all so busy, we live in different parts of the city. How do you stay connected so that someone doesn't fall off and we don't see them for a few weeks and no one knows how to get in touch with them or how to check in with them? And Facebook helps with some of that, but it's not the same as stopping by and giving them a hug and just letting them know that we care about them. And
I hear it all the time. People say, "Oh, you know, I've been gone for a long time. I'll be back next week." You know, I don't know what happened. Well, stuff happens, and
right.
the longer you're away, the easier it is to stay away. It happens mm-hmm. just like that. But they'll come, and then they're all excited about being here. And I'll be here next week. I'll be here Sunday.
Yeah.
Sunday coming up here.
Well, I think of John, who was a visitor here.
Yeah, and it's
you
just
know.
You know, you, there's countless.
Know how to even get in touch
happens
with
happens to. And it's just, you know, I know they mean it when they say it. It isn't like they're being hypocrites or liars or anything. It's, they really mean it when they say it. It's just that in that few days, because they don't have the connection,
right.
outside, as you say, outside
right.
the church,
yep.
it's just easy to blow it off and figure, I don't know.
Well, and sometimes just getting here are wherever our home is, but it's a different dark cloud somewhere else that isn't the same oppression for us.
Right.
And we can suddenly see the sun more clearly. We can hear the birds more clearly. We can smell the flowers more clearly, just because it's not that home environment. So just pray that God gives you wisdom on that. There's something about just getting away. It gives you perspective that you don't get entrenched in our normal circumstances. So definitely pray for you. Did you have your
faith? Yeah, I just saw Hamlin a little bit ago, and she had an exhausting day. She was at a funeral.
Just for peace for the hearts of your people, Lord. Peace for James, Lord. Peace for the hearts of those that are here tonight, Lord. That you encourage those that can't be with us tonight, Lord, the members of this body that are not here tonight. But those that are, Lord, we come tonight to lift you up, Lord, to seek your heart, Lord. To seek your word, Lord, to be transformed and to be matured, Lord, by the hearing and then the doing of your word, Lord. Let us not be hearers only, but doers, Lord, lovers. Fathers, mothers, Lord, to those that need the mentorships, the relationships, the hope and the truth and the life that comes only through you, Lord. Lord, as you prayed and taught your disciples how to pray, Lord, that it's our same prayer, Lord, that your kingdom would come, Lord, that your kingdom would come and be established in this earth, Lord, that your glory would cover the whole earth, Lord, and that your will would be done, Lord. Reveal yourself to us through your word, through the songs of praise, Lord, and through the voices of those around us, Lord. You speak to us in all things, Lord. You speak to us in all things, Lord. Give us ears to hear, Lord, what you would have for us. Give us eyes to see the path that is before us, Lord. Let us be led and guided by your Spirit, Lord. Let us look to you in all things, for you are our hope and our firm foundation, Lord. We thank you that you never leave us, you never forsake us, Lord. We thank you that you have made a way in those situations where we cannot see the way, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that we have no fear. We have no fear, Lord. We live boldly in your grace. We walk and move and have our being in you, Lord. In your grace, covered by your blood, renewed by your Spirit, moment by moment, Lord. We live to give you glory, to reveal you in all the earth, Lord. And we say that you are worthy. You are worthy of praise and honor and glory. hearts of those that need encouragement, Lord. Give food to those that hunger. Give drink to those that thirst. And will you receive all the glory in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. All right, let's speak the word tonight. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? Yes, Lord. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Yes, Lord. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. And I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the Word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Yes, Lord. John, would you like to come take the offering, please?
Thank you for your great love and for this time that we have, Lord.
this place, Lord.
Rejoice!
Afterward he brought me again unto the door of the house, and behold, waters issued out from under the threshold of the house eastward, for the forefront of the house stood toward the east, and the waters came down from under from the right side of the house, at the south side of the altar. Then brought he me out of the way to the gate of the gate northward, and led me about the way without unto the outer gate by the way that looketh eastward, and behold, there ran out waters on the right side. And when the man that had the line in his hand went forth eastward, he measured 1,000 cubits, and he brought me through the waters. The waters were to the ankles. Again he measured 1,000 and brought me through the waters. The waters were to the knees. Again he measured 1,000 and brought me through. The waters were to the loins. Afterward he measured 1,000, and it was a river that I could not pass over, for the waters were risen, waters to swim in, a river that could not be passed over. And he said unto me, Son of man, hast thou seen this? Then he brought me and caused me to return to the brink of the river. Now when I had returned, behold, at the bank of the river were very many trees on the one side and on the other. Then he said unto me, these waters issue out towards the east country and go down into the desert and go into the sea, which being brought forth into the sea, the waters shall be healed. And it shall come to pass that everything that liveth, which moveth, whithersoever the river shall come, shall live. And there shall be a very great multitude of fish, because these waters shall come thither, for they shall be healed, and everything shall live whither the river cometh. Showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the midst of the street of it, and of either side of the river, was there the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits, and yielded her fruits every month, and the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations.
The nations. Prepare that way. Prepare the way to the river of the Lord. Prepare the way. Prepare the way.
Let's hold fast to confess. not be blown by the wind. I'm holding on to what's written on my heart and longing for him. Prepare the way, prepare the way, prepare the way of the coming of the Son. Prepare the way.
confiado, Señor, porque todo lo que hay dentro de mi corazón necesito más de ti. Renuévame, Jesús, ya quiero ser
epiphany, you know, quoting a revelation. Doesn't it seem so simple after you have it? Like, God, why didn't I see that? It's been right there all along, you know. And it's, for some reason, whatever reason, our humanity and our natural minds are at enmity with God. And they just, not that God hates us or is against us or anything else, but our natural way of thinking just doesn't connect with the way God thinks. And so I want to look at a few things here tonight, beginning in 1 John chapter 2 and verse 6. 1 John chapter 2, verse 6. Praise the Lord. Hasn't God been good to us this week? My Lord, this has been, it's been like September or something. It's been great. But get ready, because you know what that means. 91 and humidity next week. Hallelujah. Okay. He that saith he abideth in him ought himself also to walk even as he walked. Hallelujah. Now, I know we hear all kinds of stuff preached about things like that, but I want us to get past the just what we've always heard, because he that saith he abideth in him ought himself also to walk even as he walked. Have you ever sung the words to a song wrong? Man, I'm telling you, in the 60s, that was easy to do. You know, you thought you were singing it right, but later on you found out you've been singing it wrong for 20 years. And then when you hear the actual words, you go, wow. But, you know, you just kind of stuck something in there. And Louie, Louie, whoa, baby, we got to go. But there's been, I don't know, a lot of that I sang them right along with them on the radio, you know, or on the stereo. And when they come to certain words, I'm just singing my words, and I'm sure it must be the right ones until I actually hear it. And then I go, my God, what were you thinking? Well, how about detectives? You know, they always investigating the crime scene, and they always call up eyewitnesses. The problem with eyewitnesses is everybody gives a different statement. They saw the same thing, but one of them will say, yeah, the guy had a beard, and the other one will say, well, he was clean shaven, and one will say, you know, he's 6'2", 240, and the other will say, he's about 5'9", 175, and, you know, he was wearing a hat, and another one says, nah, he had blonde, long blonde hair, you know, I mean, it just, they're not good when it comes to trying to prosecute somebody, because you'll have all these conflicting views and memories of things that happened from different people that saw the very same thing. So memory is a funny thing. You know, we think we remember things exactly as they happened, but the truth is, more often than not, our memory is just way off. It's just far from perfect. Mm-hmm. Whether it's remembering words to a song or people at a crime scene or teaching about the Bible, it's possible that memory can actually change the facts in our minds and make us believe things that aren't even true. John, in the Gospel of John, chapter 8, verse 31 and 32. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if you continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Now, praise the Lord, knowing human memory is flawed, is it possible that some of the things that we've been taught about the Bible weren't actually taught to us at all? We just remember it that way. Now, the Jews had a specific perception or remembrance of scriptures and things that didn't actually coincide with what God was actually saying. They had given an interpretation of it that was flawed. So everything that they remembered relative to that was also flawed. And that's why Jesus said, if you continue in my word, then you're my disciples. And then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. You know, more than anything else, I want to be free. Not free so that I can just be a bad person and get away with it, but free because that's what Jesus died to give me. That's the sacrifice he made, was for my freedom. Amen? He came to set captives free. Praise God. So, sometimes isn't, you know, what we think we've been taught, we weren't actually taught at all. We just remember it as though we were taught it that way. And how about this? Even more likely than that, how about other people are teaching concepts from the Bible that they think they remember being taught to them? Now, I can tell you, say, well, come on, you're just going off on a rabbit trail here. But I can tell you this for a fact. I've taught for, 25 years, 30 years almost. And I can't tell you how many times people have come to me telling me what I taught them, which wasn't what I taught at all. Now, either I'm just really a bad teacher, or they're hearing stuff I'm not saying. Or they're hearing it, and now there could be a combination of things going on here. I may not be the greatest teacher, but I have people come back and tell me things that I've said that I didn't say at all. But they heard it that way. And so they go away believing that, or believing that that's what I taught, at least, if not actually believing what it was that they think I said. So, praise the Lord. All that's possible, and it could be affecting our perception of God. If it's possible that we're hearing things that are not being taught. In other words, we're hearing things differently than they actually are in the Bible.
Right.
And if that's true, then it affects the way we understand God. Our perception of God. Amen? Things that the Bible doesn't even say. But we think it says it because somebody else thought that's what it said and that's what they taught. Or that's what we hear them teach. You know, if you've had a lot of teaching in a certain area, and then you go, listen, I'll tell you something. We were one God, Jesus name, apostolic, Holy Ghost, shouting, long-haired women, no-haired men, you know, the whole standard thing and everything else. Well, when we left the organization, when I refused to sign my license, the renewal of my license, and this has been whenever that was, 20 years ago now, we didn't know where to go to church. We just needed some place where we could go and worship, and we didn't know where to go. We'd come from something that was so different than from the main line that it was difficult to find a place where we could fit in. And we weren't trying to make a statement. We weren't trying to convert anybody. I wasn't wanting to preach. We just wanted some place where we could go and say, Lord, we're still being faithful. You know, we still want to worship you and be here and, you know, give and so forth. We went to a lot of different churches. One of them we went to was a Methodist church, of all places, because I mean, this was so totally disconnected from where we'd been. But it was only a couple blocks from our house, so we went there. We went to a lot of different churches, but I remember going to this one. And I heard one of the best Jesus name messages ever preached by this Methodist minister who I know did not believe any of that. But that's what I was hearing, because that's what I've heard. So no matter what he said or how he said it, I was still hearing what had already been my teaching for years. You understand what I'm saying? That happens. You get a particular way of thinking about things and understanding of things that no matter what somebody else is saying, you're hearing the same stuff anyhow. You're still hearing it. This is what was happening. And I think it happens with us all the time. You know, it's not so much what we don't know that affects our vision in terms of how God wants to move or how God is speaking to us or what God is trying to do. It's not what we don't know that necessarily messes up our relationship with God. I mean, I'll tell you, I've talked to people who had no religious background at all, but came to an awareness of Jesus and gave their life to Christ without being in church, without being connected with the church, and had some profound revelations. Because nobody had had a chance to mess with their heads yet. And you know, I mean, everybody's had situations like that. Some of the quickest growth that a person has is when they're first born again, before you start getting the indoctrination of a particular denomination or a particular slant on someone else's perceptions and beliefs about the Bible. And I'll just give you an example. When I was a kid, we didn't have a swimming pool in the town I went to. We did have a creek that we'd go to. But whenever we would go to a pool, and at the time the closest pool to where we lived was East Town here. It was called Teach Out. It was East Town, then it was Teach Out. Now it's a water park of some kind next to the East Side Library there. But it was the only swimming pool within, I don't know, 30, 40 miles of where I lived. And we'd go, and if you ate anything, you couldn't get in the water for at least a half hour. So I wouldn't eat, because I didn't want to miss any pool time. Because my option was a cattle manure-fed creek about 3 miles from my house. And it wasn't near as fun scuba diving there as it was at the pool. So I wouldn't eat. But that was the deal. And I wonder how many hours of swimming kids missed because of that 30-minute rule that, you know, if you eat and get in the pool within 30 minutes, you'll end up with cramps. Amen? A lot of angry kids, when they got older, like I did, and found out that eating before you get in the water don't make a bit of difference. In fact, you're more likely to get cramps from not eating than you are from eating. So there's a lot of frustrated middle-aged people today who missed out on a lot of pool time because of a misperception, a misnomer, a wrong teaching, right? Amen? So the point I'm making is, you know, we thought we knew what was right. We thought we knew that we were keeping kids out of the pool for their safety after they ate. We thought it was the right thing to do, but it was just bogus. And so I'm wondering, could the same thing be true in our perceptions of God? Maybe there are beliefs that we have and that we think are right, and we're convinced that these views of the Bible or God are true, but the Bible doesn't really support them. Look at Psalms chapter 34 and verse 8. And this is really an interesting scripture. I've looked at it over the years, and I'm seeing, I think, maybe what God is trying to say here more today than I have in the past, because I'm seeing things differently. Now, for some of you, you know, what I'm teaching may not be a great leap of faith or change in theology, but coming from where I was born again, this is like another planet. And it didn't happen in 24 hours or in 24 days or months. It's been a process of over probably 20 years. So discipling never ends, I guess, is what I'm saying to some degree. Revelation never ends. It's just a question of how much we're willing to accept at any given time, however we're able to let go of some things in order to grasp the next thing that God has. But it says, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusteth in him." Amen? Taste, the Bible says. Now, look, God's got a huge vocabulary, and he could have used any word he wanted here. He could have said anything. But he chose a word that deals with our experiences. Amen? He doesn't tell us to hear about it. Doesn't tell us to read about it. God's goodness I'm talking about. He tells us to taste it. To experience it. It's like the difference between we've had grandkids. In fact, the first year or so of Allison's oldest daughter, they lived with us. So we were back into the baby food stuff. And I can remember, oh my God, it looks like vomit. You know, I mean, I'm sorry, but you open up the jar and just you think, well, who could eat this? I mean, even a little kid, it's horrible. And I've tasted it, you know how you do, this is really good. You go, oh my God. This is abuse. This is child abuse, you know. But anyhow, you know, the difference between baby food and real food, the minute that kid gets a bite of mashed potatoes and gravy, you can throw the jars away because they are not going to eat it again. You know? And it's like they have an epiphany. It's like, what was I doing? What was I thinking? Eating anything coming out of that jar. And so I just figured, if that works, imagine what I could be to them. So I'd get ice cream, popsicles, bubble gum. This is like almost Jehovah. You know, praise the Lord. I gave them something better. And they don't want anything but the better. Every time they're gum. They want gum. They want, you know, ice cream. They want, now I know that's probably not a wise thing, but hey, I'm the grandparent. I don't care. But the same is true with grace. Once you taste grace, rules, regulations, legalism, law, it'll make you sick. It makes you sick to even see somebody else who's in that grip of that thing. And you're wanting to say, man, do you know what you're eating? Do you have any idea what you're putting in yourself here? What you could have? I mean, I believe that grace is bigger. The grace of God is bigger than any of us can imagine, because God is greater than any of us can imagine. We haven't imagined, it hasn't entered into our imagination, the things that God has for us. Praise the Lord. But to really appreciate God's grace, we've got to be willing to admit that we don't have everything correctly sorted out in our belief system. We can't be so bullheaded, if you will, so stubborn in thinking that we got it all together here. We got all the answers now. Because we don't. I didn't have 20 years ago, and I don't today. I got a whole lot better than what I had 20 years ago in terms of, I believe, a revelation of God's true character and nature. But I still don't have it all. And I can get hung up in even minimizing God in this area to where I can't experience God in everything that God wants to do. God wants us all healed. He wants us all to prosper. He wants our relationships restored and made whole. He wants our lives to be abundant. Yes. I believe that, but we don't really experience it in the same manner in which I believe God is declaring this truth to be in the Bible. And it has to do with grace. It still has to do with this big God and His big grace. Amen? Amen. Praise the Lord. Look at Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through 30. I want us to be excited every day about what the possibilities are for that day. And then again the next day. We should get up every morning with a thrill in us, like the kid getting ready to go to the swimming pool, or you're going to go to Adventureland or Seven Flags or whatever the thing is, you know. This excitement, Christmas, you know, that every day there's going to be some great gift unwrapped, and we're going to experience something of God that we've never experienced before, because that's the way He wants us to live our lives, with joy unspeakable, you know, abundant life, like an exciting life. No, not this again. But even though we got the same job or the same kind of routine, within that routine, God can do all sorts of things that we never imagined. We've got to believe Him for it, though. We've got to trust Him that that's what He wants to do, and have some expectations so that when we come into these these kind of crossroads and interactions with people, we're expecting something really dynamic, something really big, that God's going to reveal something, you know, tremendous that we never experienced before. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You ever hear the story about the two guys were out fishing? And this one guy's catching huge fish. I mean, they're out in this lake, and the one guy's watching him, and he reels in. Well, I mean, the thing is like this. And he unhooks it and throws it back. 10 minutes later, he's cranking away, and the rod's bent at a 90-degree angle, and he's pulling, and he whips out another one's like this, and he takes it off the hook and throws it back. And the other guy's just scratching his head. He's saying, what in the world is going on? About the fourth or fifth time he's reeling in this mammoth fish and lets it go, the guy says, what are you doing? Those are trophy fish. Those are great. Those are the biggest fish I've seen come out of this lake. And he says, well, they won't fit in my frying pan. So see, what I'm saying is God doesn't fit in my frying pan brain. I got this limited kind of ideas, even though it may be bigger than what they were before, it still doesn't encompass what God can do. So anything that doesn't fit my frying pan, I'm throwing it back. I'm more comfortable. See, God's big truth is too much for my brain. So I'll stick to the little understanding that I've got and continue to labor. That's what Jesus is saying here. Come to me. All you that labor and are heavy laden, I got something really big here, and it isn't going to cost you anything, and you don't have to exert any energy for it at all. You just got to believe for it. You just got to come to me and expect that I'm going to do it. Praise the Lord. Colossians chapter 3, verses 3 and 4. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. Praise the Lord. Now, I tell you, Sally will back me up on this. I love steak, good steak. I don't know that I've ever had bad steak, but some steak is better than other steak, and I like really good steak, so. And she does a good job, too. But you know what really gripes me? Is you go to some restaurants, and they give you a bunch of cheap appetizers before your steak comes. They'll try to fill you up with bread or a blooming onion. Or whatever it might be, depending on the restaurant. They always got something, though. They always got some deal going, and they want you to, you know, load up. So, and you know, we get the attitude that this is like grace. It's just more, you know. It doesn't cost me. The bread's free. You know. But what happens after you've eaten a bunch of mediocre appetizers? When the real food comes, you're already full. And not really as interested in the steak as you might have been. And maybe that's the problem with our perceptions of God as well. Philippians 1:21. For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. To live is Christ. To die is gain. Now that is a huge thing to try to get my brain around. Jesus is the fullness of the Godhead. He's the all and all. The Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end, you know. He's it. He's everything. In him, all of the fullness of God, all of the blessings, all of the promises, everything, it's there. all in grace, right? To live is that. To die is even better. I don't want to die. I mean, you know what I'm saying? I don't want to die without experiencing the all that I should have had here. The Christ, the fullness, the satisfied, overflowing, abundant life that we are supposed to be experiencing here and now. See, we fill ourselves up on the religious culture that we live in. And then we hear teaching about God, but we're so full of religious appetizers when it comes time for the steak and for us to let God be everything, our finished work, we don't really have the appetite for it. See, God is not asking us to be copycats of Jesus. When Jesus said in 1 John chapter 2, where he says, "He that saith he abideth in him ought himself also to walk even as he walked," he's not telling us to ape Jesus or to copycat Jesus. God wants to be your whole life. That's what he's telling us in Philippians. If you think that living the Christian life as we have understood it is making God number one over everything else, then he's not your life. He's just something you're trying to coordinate within your life. What if Christian life is completely different than anything you've imagined or known? That's what I'm seeing. It is so not what I thought it was that I can't even quite describe what it is, except that it's not what I thought. It's so much bigger. It's so much better. It's so much less me and more him. It's so little self consciousness and so much God consciousness. It has so little to do with my petty failures and so much with his total success. What if what the Bible says is really true and what we've been taught is false? What if everything is ours? What if we are healed? What if we are prospered? What if we have all things? What if we are more than conquerors? What if this isn't about how good I am tomorrow, how good he's already been? I believe that grace is bigger than any of us have ever given it credit or ever been able to imagine. It does not have limits. Can we just accept that? Can we handle that big a truth? Have we got a pan big enough to put that in? That's exactly right. It's finished. Everything. Everything. Can you, I mean, I'm saying, if we really could ever fathom this, every day would be a holiday and every meal a feast. Praise the Lord. I'd live forever and you'd never die. Praise the Lord. That's my message tonight. Get a bigger pan. You know, I mean, jump in the water. It's okay. Quit eating the blooming onions. Wait for the steak. It's good. Praise the Lord. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. That's what I want us to do. I want us to expand our minds. Let's let's do what John and I were trying to do back in the 60s with the help of external things and just get it from Jesus. This is the year of the expanding man. Praise the Lord. This is the time of expanding people. Hallelujah. God's glory is filling the earth, and he's going to do it through us. Praise the Lord. Let's experience every bit of his grace. Let's no holds barred. Amen. Let's believe him for anything and everything, every day, all day. Amen. Don't ever stop. Amen. Enjoy the Lord. Amen. And all that he's given us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. In the name of Jesus, then, I bless you and dismiss you in that name above every name. Hallelujah.